In previous episodes, we discussed what it means to be an animal. Now that we know the rules on how to distinguish between one animal type and another, so we note that the difference between our animal ancestors and true animals was the distinction of eukaryotic cells becoming multicellular. And this is essentially where our animal lineage begins, with the first multicellular eukaryotes that ingest their food. We're talking about sponges now. Sponges are essentially organisms made up of a package of cells. They don't have tissue types. They just have a bunch of different cells, many of which are specialized for performing particular functions. Multicellularity has its origin in the embryonic stage, when the fertilized zygote then undergoes cellular division. It will divide and divide and divide until there are many, many cells that make up this blastomere, which is basically a fluid-filled sac surrounded by a layer of cells. In the cases of the most primitive animals, these cells developed into specialized roles, but there were no layers that formed in the animal. As we shall see later, specialized layers were the origin of tissues. Multicellularity is a situation in which cells are mutually obliged to be part of the same organism, bound by their common relationship in that they wouldn't be able to survive on their own. So if I was to cut off my thumb, it probably wouldn't last very long without the rest of me. And that's because in more complex animals, the cells are much more specialized to perform just one or maybe a few roles, and that those cells require all the other cells from the entire organism to achieve all of their needs. But that's not true for all animals. Has this ever happened to you? You try to remove a body part in order to make another organism, but it just doesn't work. Those darn specialized cells. Well, no longer, because with the Super Spongematic 2000 from Ronco, we can blend up our sponges into a million pieces and still have a whole living organism. That's right, folks, it slices, it dices, it mixes, it matches, and all we need to do here is just take our sponge and put it in the Super Spongematic 2000 from Ronco. Though we take our sponge, that's right, the whole sponge, and we put it in the Super Spongematic 2000 from Ronco. We close that up, and we find the power setting that suits our needs. So now we've got our sponge mixture here from the Super Spongematic 2000 from Ronco, and all we need to do now is to pour it into our little receptacle, and almost immediately those sponge cells will begin joining up with one another and reforming a whole organism. Refreshing and rejuvenating. So in case you didn't notice, no living sponges were harmed in the filming of this episode. High five, real sponge. So the point is that with sponges, multicellularity is still a bit of a loose relationship. It's possible for them to be able to regenerate body parts when those cells become separated from one another.
The ability to regenerate also contributes to a sponge's ability to survive breakage or injury from being attacked by predators. It can simply regrow the parts that have been lost from the cells that have pluripotent ability, which refers to their stem cell ability to develop into any number of kinds of cells. Now, in sponges, the main body form is essentially a tube or a kind of chimney with holes in it, and the specialized cells in the interior draw water through pores in the body wall that will also bring food particles of organic material or small microorganisms that will then be ingested by the specialized feeding cells in the inside, before the excess water is expelled out through the top of the chimney. There's also a more crust-like body form, where the sponges do not necessarily form tall chimneys, but the mechanism is more or less the same, where water is still drawn in through pores, and the food and respiratory gases are extracted through the specialized cells in the interior chambers. What are these specialized cells? Well, they bear a striking resemblance to those choanoflagellate protists that we saw earlier. Where a cell body is surrounded by a sticky collar with a flagellum sticking out. These are also the same kinds of current-forming and digestive cells that are found in the inner lining of the spongocoel, or the sponge's inner cavity. Their filter feeding process is one in which the flagellum beats like a whip and draws a current which aspires water from the outside through those pores. And carrying their organic material that they'll feed upon, the particles of organic material will become stuck to the mucus-coated collar that will then shuttle those food particles down towards the main cell body and will be engulfed into a digestive vacuole for digestion within the cell. Now, sponges are sedentary animals, which means that they're incapable of moving around, and this provides a number of challenges to meet certain needs in their life cycle. One of the challenges, of course, is not being able to evade predation by running away, for example. As we just saw, by creating a water current, they can bring their food to them, since they can't displace to meet the food. Other issues may be related to the seeking of sexual partners. In the case of threats to their survival, sponges can't swim away from their attackers. So, they have developed both physical and chemical defenses that they can use to put up a fight. So instead, sponges have very sharp, spiky structures inside the body of the organism known as spicules that can be made up of silica or calcium carbonate. They are very sharp with teeth and spikes all over them. These spicules do provide somewhat of a skeletal structure for the organism itself, but they also, very importantly as well, provide an effective deterrent to feeding. Any predator who tries to take a bite out of one of these will experience the not very pleasant sensations of those spines jabbing into the soft tissues of the inside of their mouths. Sponges also have chemical defenses that discourage predators, either by tasting bad or inducing nausea. But that's not the only challenge for which sponges have developed a chemical solution. Because they occupy a niche in the marine environment that is in limited supply, that is, shelves and other substrates, they're also in competition with other sedentary organisms, like corals, for example, for which they would compete for access to that limited habitat. As a result, they also produce growth inhibitors that prevent other organisms like corals growing around them and taking up that important real estate. To satisfy the need for sexual reproduction in a sedentary organism, the solution in this case is to produce gametes that are capable of being taken up in the water column for external fertilization. Once the embryo develops into a larva, it is slightly mobile as well, and can disperse to locate another substrate upon which it can fix to satisfy dispersal of individuals that is otherwise impossible when you're stuck to the ocean floor. The next type of organism to evolve is one that has had a modification in the embryological development to form an internal layer and an outer external layer through this process of gastrulation. As we see, the invagination of one side of the embryo creates an infolding that will become the lining of the alimentary canal. Cnidaria are the simplest animals that undertake this gastrulation process. There are more than 11,000 species of cnidaria, including jellyfish, anemones, and coral. Their digestive tract is incomplete, in the sense that only one hole is made via the blastopore that acts both as a mouth and as an anus for excreting undigestible or digested waste materials. There's an internal layer made up of endoderm and an external layer made up of ectoderm with a bunch of jelly in between known as mesoglia. And this is the basis for the body type of cnidaria. The body type for jellyfish and polyps includes having a gastrovascular cavity which has been created by this gastrulation process, with a mouth that also acts as an anus. Aren't you glad you're not a cnidaria? There are two main body forms in the life cycle of cnidaria. The polyp, which is attached to a surface and has a ring of tentacles around its mouth, leading to that stomach. The other form is the jellyfish, or medusa form, that is free-swimming and inverted with the mouth towards the bottom, but again with a ring of tentacles. It's essentially a flipped version of the polyp, and one that is able to be mobile to disperse for feeding and sexual reproduction. So one thing that we will note with the development of a stomach is that for the first time, it allows animals to digest larger food items than can fit inside a single cell. Secondly, it allows an adaptation where digestion can begin in the stomach itself before bringing the food particles into the cells for further breakdown, which increases digestive efficiency. So if we look at a cross-section of the body wall of a cnidaria polyp, we see that the outside layer from ectoderm becomes the epidermis, and this is made up of epitheliomuscular cells, which implies that they are skin cells that have contractile ability for movement. And on the other side of the jelly layer of mesoglea, we have the gastrodermis, being the layer of cells that line the stomach or the gastrovascular cavity. These cells that line the stomach are nutritive muscular cells that are secretory, meaning that they can secrete enzymes and acids and other digestive fluids into the gastrovascular cavity to begin digestion extracellularly. This digestion outside of the cells, but still inside the stomach, is further favored by agitation of the fluid contents with the beating action of these cilia that extend from the cells lining that stomach. The process of extracellular digestion is one in which the food particles are broken down outside of the body's cells, albeit inside the stomach, before they are brought into the cells for further intracellular digestion. This allows for ingestion of larger food items and for a prolonged digestion, which favors increased digestive efficiency. Speaking of food, you may be surprised to hear that these sedentary or very slow-moving animals are actually predators. But how is it possible that they can feed on other organisms if they can barely move to get anywhere themselves? The answer lies in specialized stinging and harpoon cells that are found in their epidermis known as cnidocytes. These cnidocytes house an inverted whip-like filament called a nematocyst that is coiled under tension and enclosed in the cnidocyte cell with an operculum, or a lid, if you will, ready to fire once the epidermis is stimulated by contact with another organism. The whole mechanism is released by this trigger-like cnidocil. It works very much like a jack-in-the-box, in that the nematocyst is ready to fire under tension inside its capsule. And once the cnidocil is stimulated by rubbing up against another organism, the lid opens up and then the nematocyst fires on its own and penetrates the tissues of the other organism, often embedding those tissues with irritant, poisonous, or neurotoxic chemicals. Additionally, the filament is covered in hooks and barbs that act as a harpoon to hang on and hold that organism. This is what allows cnidaria to feed on other organisms despite the fact that they can't chase them down. These firing cnidocyte cells act as harpoons for them to catch their prey and draw them into their gastrovascular cavity. When we refer back to the needs of animals, a lot of them are dependent on some ability to move around, or to acquire resources or nutrients or other organisms that may not be nearby. And this applies equally to sexual reproduction. In this case, we will see that the metamorphosis between polyp and the medusa phase in the life cycle is an adaptation to allow jellyfish to meet the requirements of reproduction by completing the life cycle. The jellyfish or medusa is the adult phase, that is, the sexually mature phase. And that's essentially the definition of an adult animal, that they've reached sexual maturity and are capable of completing that life cycle by reproducing. However, these jellyfish also come with the mobile ability to disperse themselves, albeit a little clumsily and without much propulsion ability, as you can see. but still employing some use of currents and a small amount of muscular contraction of that sort of umbrella-like bell, so that they can disperse themselves to other locations, release their gametes, that is, the sperm and egg cells, into the water column for external fertilization. And then, of course, the embryo is also somewhat mobile, with cilia that can swim around and fix itself down to the surface in order to metamorphose into a new polyp, therefore starting the next phase of the life cycle. In these animals, we've seen that fertilization is largely external. This is an inefficient form of reproduction because there's a lot of wastage. And it's rather random, too, in terms of the species relying on a lucky break with one sperm happening to find and unite with another ovule in the vastness of that watery environment. So what we find is that the release of the gametes is often triggered by environmental stimuli, such as certain temperature fluctuations that occur annually, or certain phases of lunar cycles, such that different organisms in the population can synchronize their reproductive behavior to be there at the right time. We also find that many of these organisms are hermaphrodites, meaning that they are both male and female. The word hermaphrodite refers to the offspring of Hermes and Aphrodite, who had a two-sexed child together who was named Hermaphroditus. By the way, Hermes was smitten with Aphrodite, but she wasn't so hot for him. She rejected him at first, and only gave in when he took one of her sandals and insisted that she have sex with him before he return it. I guess the moral of the story is either keep your footwear somewhere safe, or don't get too attached to it. Anyway, hermaphrodite is a contraction of those two names from that dead language, ancient Greek. In biology, we call hermaphroditic organisms monoecious, which means one house for the two sexes, since both sexes are found in the same organism. The second root is the same as eco, from ecology, which means the study of our home, and economy, which is meant to mean the management of our home, although I'd argue that economists haven't been doing such a great job on that count. Later on in animal evolution, the sexes are separated into different individuals and become known as dioecious, meaning that there are in fact two houses for those different sexes, but that early on, hermaphrodite is much more common. A big disadvantage of being a hermaphrodite, such as this snail, would be self-fertilization, because you lose the benefits of sexual reproduction, namely generating genetic diversity in the next generation by mixing genes from different individuals. You obviously don't get any genetic variation if you reproduce with yourself. You will actually be creating some kind of clone. All right, come on, that's enough, you guys. Out of here. All right, out of here. Talk about a narcissist. So, in order to avoid self-fertilization and promote cross-fertilization in hermaphrodite animals, there's a difference in the timing of sexual development, which is generally male first and female reproductive phases secondly. At first, the hermaphrodite will present sexually as a male form, releasing sperm until that male phase is done, at which point the animal will develop into its female phase and release eggs or ovules. That gap in time between the male and female phases prevents the physical union of their own sperm and eggs, and also promotes cross-fertilization between different individuals that have different timings for the shift between male and female phases. Lastly, all animals have important requirements for diffusion, such as respiration to acquire oxygen and to release waste gases like CO2, and also to excrete food wastes from the processes of digestive metabolism. What we note with these simple animals is that no adaptations are required to satisfy these particular needs, because they are surrounded by water, both inside and out. they also have a high level of surface area contact. Via Fick's law, we note that diffusion is promoted passively just because of the large circulation of water, both within and without these animals, that allow them to breathe and to excrete just through passive diffusion, and therefore don't require any adaptations. So we've yet to see in animal evolution any features that may promote these needs, because to date they haven't been required. So far, we've seen that the basal, simple animals have either been just a mass of cells, or they're just a couple of layers of tissue making up their bodies. Also, that they're surrounded by water, both within and without, meaning that passive diffusion satisfies most of their needs. They may be very simple animals, but they've been very successful at surviving. 700 million years is a testament to the advantages of simplicity. But as we'll see in the next episode, sometimes in order to get ahead, you have to grow ahead.